Well, good evening, everyone. It is 7 o'clock, and I think that we will get started. I'd like to welcome you all to the initial meeting of the board on December 7th, 2021. I will be chairing the first little bit of this meeting until following the election for chair and that a chair has been declared. And I will begin with the acknowledgement, and we'd like to acknowledge that we are meeting on the traditional land of Saugeen and Ojibwe Nation, whose people are represented by the communities of Saugeen First Nation and Chippewas of Naiwishon Seated First Nation. And we also think of the Métis people of Ontario, whose history and people are well represented within Bruce and Gray counties. We do have regrets tonight from Trustee Boy Zhang, and those are the only regrets that we have received. So I will just share a moment of reflection. The holiday season is quickly approaching, and since this is our last board meeting of 2021, I would like to take this opportunity to share best wishes on behalf of the senior team to all our Blue Water District School Board students, trustees, staff, families, partners, and communities. Regardless of the traditions you observe at this time of year, it is my hope that you will find many special moments among family and friends. I also want to extend gratitude and appreciation to all of you for the continued hard work, creativity, passion, and professionalism demonstrated over the past year to support a positive learning and working experience for our students and staff. Later this evening, I will share the annual director's report to celebrate everyone's collective efforts and to highlight some of the amazing examples of our progress in Blue Water District School Board. Please know that all of you are captured in the spirit of this report. For this evening's moment of reflection, I invite you to join me to reflect on and express thankfulness for the accomplishments, collaboration, and determination that contributed to student success and well-being in our board during 2021. We also think about the year ahead and share our hopes and wishes for a healthy, safe, and prosperous 2022 for everyone in our school communities. Okay, thank you for those reflections. And then moving along the agenda, we'll move to A1A, and these are the elections. So as I mentioned, I will preside for the election of the chair, and I would like to put forward a call for a motion to open the nominations. I need a mover and a seconder. Okay, I have Trustee Dawson as a mover and Trustee Johnstone as a seconder. Thank you very much. And then moving forward, I just need a mover for this one, that nominations for the position of chair be open. I need one mover. Thank you, Trustee. So the nominations are open, and anybody wishing to nominate? Yes, Trustee Morgan.
Thank you, Chair. I would like to nominate Jane Thompson for chair for this current year or upcoming year. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So do you accept and let your name stand for that?
Yes, I do. Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much. So I will be asking, are there further nominations for the position of chair? Any other further nominations for the position of chair? And the last opportunity, any other further nominations for the position of chair? Okay, congratulations. Trustee Thompson, you have you will be the chair, and you've been acclaimed this year, so thank you very much. Do you have any comments that you would like to make at this time?
Thank you very much. Thank you for your support. It will be my honor to continue to serve the board as the chair. We are entering into our final year of this Board of Trustees four-year mandate. This is our opportunity to continue the work that is important to us as a board, guided by our strategic plan as we work together to keep the focus on the well-being and achievement of every student in Blue Water. So thank you again. Look forward to our work this year. Thank you.
And I'll turn it then to you, Chair Thompson, for continuing the meeting.
Thank you. So we are now going to elect our vice chair, and I would like a mover and seconder that the nominations for the position of vice chair be opened. Could I have a mover and seconder, please? Trustee Atkinson and Trustee McComb. And we'll need a mover. Be opened. So the nominations for the position of vice chair now be opened. I need a mover for that. Trustee Morgan, thank you. So are there any nominations for the position of vice chair? I have one. If I would like to nominate Trustee Johnstone to the position of vice chair. Trustee Johnstone, will you let your name stand?
Yes, I will. Thank you very much.
And as we did with the chair, we ask three times. Are there any additional nominations for the position of vice chair? And one more time, is there any other nominations for the position of vice chair? I see none. So Trustee Johnstone will be our vice chair, but I'll need a mover and seconder that the nominations for the position of vice chair be closed. I see Trustee Dawson and Trustee McComb. And Trustee Johnstone has been declared our vice chair. Would you like to make any comments?
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. And very much like you, Chair Thompson, I recognize that this upcoming year is the last year of our four-year term. And with all the things that have happened in this term, and I guess particularly around, first of all, we hired a new director, and then we were in a pandemic. And ever since that point, we have all been working really hard, pivoting all the time and being very, very flexible. And I'm really hoping that, as we go into the last stride of our board, that we ensure that all the things that we plan to do in our strategic plan, that we're all very successful. And of course, my goal is to be very supportive of the chair and also supportive of all the trustees to make sure that we're all successful so that our students can be successful in their education and career goals and also their well-being. So thank you.
Thank you. Get myself organized here. So we're now at the trustee expression of interest for appointments to statutory committees. So the first statutory committee that we have is the audit committee, and we're looking for three trustees interested in sitting on the audit committee. So first I'm going to put the motion on the floor. If I could have a mover and seconder. I don't know if you have your hands up because you want to move or second or because you want to be on the committee, but I'm going to take you as mover and seconder first. So moved by Trustee Dawson and seconded by Trustee Morgan that we appoint three trustees to the audit committee for a one-year term. Do we have any volunteers for this committee? Trustee Dawson, you're interested?
Yes.
Trustee Morgan?
Yes, I'm interested. It's such an exciting committee.
Are there any other trustees that are interested in this committee? I will do it, but I don't want anyone to not participate if you're interested. Is there anybody else?
I do believe the chair has to be on this committee, don't they?
Yeah.
Well, so it would be...
They can be.
I was also thinking if another trustee wanted to be there, I think as chair, I could just ask to join in and participate in a meeting. But if there's no other expressions, okay, someone's hand is up there.
Bev.
Bev, go ahead, Bev.
Sorry, I'm having trouble with the toggle. So typically we would look for the chair, the business committee of the whole chair, and one trustee.
Okay.
Which is where it has landed.
All right. So I think where it's landing tonight is the chair, Trustee Morgan and Trustee Dawson, who is currently our business chair. But as I say, if there was somebody I could join in as a ad hoc, so. But I think that's where we've landed. So. It will be Trustee Dawson, Trustee Morgan, and Trustee Thompson that will be appointed to the Audit Committee for a one-year term. Bev, I see your hand is still up. Have I done something wrong? No. Phew. Our next committee is the Parent Involvement Committee. That the board appoint one trustee and one alternative to the Parent Involvement Committee for a one-year term. Could I have a mover, please? Trustee Johnstone and a seconder. Trustee McComb.
And just a point of order, you might go back, Trustee Thompson, there was one motion you moved and I think you only had one mover. Can you just check on that?
For the Audit Committee, we had Trustee Dawson and Trustee Morgan.
Before that, was there something? I just remember, or maybe I missed it, but I just want to make sure at the end that we're not.
I think we're good. I have Trustee Dawson and Trustee McComb on the previous one.
Okay, thank you.
So this is moved by Trustee Johnstone, seconded by Trustee McComb, and we're looking for a member and an alternate for the Parent Involvement Committee. I know this year has been Trustee Boyd John, who is not able to join us tonight. So, but if somebody else is interested in that. Don't jump all at once. Trustee Lutz? Are you interested in this?
I had been the alternate and I can be on the committee.
Excellent. And an alternate? I can do the alternate position if that's... So it's moved by Trustee Johnston, seconded by Trustee McComb, that the board appoint one trustee, one alternate to the Parent Involvement Committee for a one-year term. It's appointing Trustee Lutz with an alternate of Trustee Thompson. All in favor? Thank you, that's carried. And that takes us to our supervised alternative learning. And we'll be looking for a mover and a seconder that the board appoint two trustees and one alternate to the supervised alternative learning committee for a one-year term. I see Trustee Atkinson's hand up as a mover. And a seconder, Trustee Morgan. And do I have some volunteers for this committee, please? I see Trustee Lutz, Trustee McComb, and Trustee Morgan. How do we want to handle that? We need, is there anyone that would be interested in doing that more as the alternate or?
As I said before, last year, I have been on this committee for my entire term, and it's one of those committees that you like to stay on because you like to follow through with the kids that are working in the SAL program, and I would very much like to be on the committee full time. Thank you.
Trustee McComb?
Yes, I too would like to stay on the committee. I've sort of been following some of the kids too.
Trustee Lutz, if you could just let us know what you're thinking, because I know that two of our trustees have spent a long time on this committee. So,
so I must have been the alternate last year as well, because I'll say I very much enjoy being a part of this committee, but I am happy to be the alternate again. I believe I must have been last year because I know I attended a meeting and it was a wonderful experience, and I am happy to stand in that position again.
Excellent. Thank you very much, Trustee Lutz.
So, yes, thank you.
It was moved by Trustee Atkinson, seconded by Trustee Morgan, that the board appoint two trustees and one alternative to the supervised alternate learning committee for a 1-year term. And we have agreed to appoint Trustee Morgan and Trustee McComb with an alternate of Trustee Lutz. All in favor? Thank you very much. And that is carried. And a reminder to people, we also have our policy meeting, which is a standing committee for our board. If you've signed up to that committee in the past, assume you're still on it. If you aren't able to keep involved with it, your circumstances have changed, your timing has changed, please let Bev know. And then the other is our business committee, which is a committee of the whole board. So we are down to our approval of the agenda for tonight. So could I have a mover and a seconder that the agenda for the initial meeting of the board of December 7th be approved as printed? Trustee McComb, seconded by Trustee Atkinson. All in favor? Thank you, that is carried. Is there any disclosure of pecuniary interest on any of the items on our agenda tonight? I see none. We have approval of the regular meeting of the board minutes from November the 16th. So I'll be looking for a mover and a seconder that the minutes of the regular meeting of the board of November 16th be approved as printed. Could I have a mover, please? Trustee Johnstone, seconder. Trustee McComb. Were there any errors or omissions that were noted in those? I see none. All in favor? Approved as printed. Thank you. That is carried. Was there any business arising from the minutes? I see none. So now we get to the good stuff of our meeting, our excellence in education, and I'd like to welcome Superintendent of Education Lefebvre. But first, let's put this report on the floor. I'll be looking for a mover and a seconder that the Blue Water District School Board receive the Arts in Blue Water report for information. Trustee Dawson and a seconder, Trustee Morgan. Thank you very much. And welcome, Superintendent Lefebvre.
Thank you very much, Chair Thompson, and congratulations to you and Vice Chair Johnstone for your appointments tonight. It is my pleasure to bring you the Excellence in Education, Blue Water and the Arts report to you this evening. I was on a visit a few weeks ago to one of my schools, Saugeen District Senior School, and I was listening to the beautiful sounds coming from the grade 11-12 instrumental class with Carrie Lynn Boyce, who was the instructor. The teacher, and they were doing such a wonderful job. And I knew when the opportunity came up for us to put an Excellence in Education, Blue Water and the Arts report together, I thought they would do a wonderful job at helping to complete that. So we've created a video with not just their class, but when I asked some of my colleagues if they had other musical talent within the district, of course we had some. And Kathy Archer, the principal at Grey Highlands Secondary School, approached Shannon Loader, and their class again. Their class was able to put together a video for us. So we've compiled the videos together for you, and you're going to hear some festive music as well as some globe-trotting music. You'll be snapping your fingers and tapping your toes, and I hope that you enjoy the presentation. Let's see. I've got this window. Here we go. And I've got to share my music. Okay. Enjoy.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much for the opportunity for us to celebrate the arts in Blue Water. We're so very proud of our students. And those are individual classes. And unless they have an administrator walking through or a strange superintendent coming through on the odd visit, they don't have many audiences to be able to play for. So this was a wonderful opportunity, and they really appreciated the chance to be able to do this. So thank you very much.
Thank you. I see we have a couple of questions or comments. First, Trustee Morgan.
I would just like to say, Superintendent Lefebvre, it was an absolute delight to hear the kids play. Loved it. The only thing I'm regretful about is that we're not in the rotunda at the board office looking at all the smiling faces. It was always such a joy. Thank you.
Trustee Atkinson. Trustee Atkinson, did you want to make a comment?
Yes, I sure do. Wow, is what I can say. It's been a long time that we haven't heard that wonderful noise, music. And as a musician myself, I appreciate that hard work. The pieces that Saugeen District played were not easy to learn, because I can remember many, many years ago learning the Weathermen, and it's very difficult. So I really appreciate all the effort and commitment, because it is a huge commitment to perform that way. It was just heartwarming. And please send our thanks to them all. And I always like to listen to Shannon Loader's class as well. It was just a job well done. And it was so nice to see the tapping of the toes, if anyone noticed. I always look for that to keep the beat. It was just phenomenal. And we are very blessed in Blue Water to have such wonderful arts in our schools, because it's just beautiful to see it again. And so thank you very much for sharing that.
Director Wilder.
Trustee Atkinson's, your passion and your acknowledgement is so lovely. I couldn't do it better, but I was going to say the same. It's just a joy to be able to hear the young people play. And I just want to as well acknowledge the teachers, Ms. Loader and Ms. Boyce. They just do a fantastic job with the students. And we are so, so very fortunate to have such dedicated educators in our system to support the arts. It's so important for students, and we're just very, very appreciative. It was lovely to see them this evening.
I just want to echo it myself, because I'm not privileged to know how to play an instrument, and I know that's a gift, a skill they'll carry through the rest of their life with them. And I do think it's such an important and valuable skill. And perhaps because we haven't been privileged to hear that over the last couple of years, it sounds all the sweeter. And I would like to echo Trustee Atkinson's wish that you make sure you send a thank you. I wish they were with us, that we could do it personally, but please thank them for us. It was lovely. Are there any other comments or questions? Thank you very much. It was moved by Trustee Dawson and seconded by Trustee Morgan that the Blue Water District School Board receive the Arts in Blue Water report for information. All in favor? Thank you. That's carried. We have no delegations for this evening. Are there, and we have no committee reports this evening. I would like to invite Vice Chair Johnstone to speak to our Committee of the Whole Board in camera meeting from earlier this evening.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I was just toggling between screens. That's all I was doing here. So yes, I'm bringing the report from the in-camera meeting for December 7th, 2021. There are three motions, and so I'm going to put the first one on the floor, that the agenda of the December 7th, 2021 Committee of the Whole Board and Camera meeting be deemed to meet the legislative requirements for discussion in Camera I'm putting it on the floor and I just need someone who's seconded in it. So thank you, Trustee McComb. And all in favor? And that has carried. Thank you very much. The next is that it is being moved by myself that the Blue Water District School Board receive the Administrative Placements Update Report for information. Can I have a seconder for that, please? And I thank you very much, Trustee Dawson. All in favor? And that is carried. Thank you very much. And then finally, that the Blue Water District School Board receive the Administrative Placement Update. Did I just do that? No, I am lost because I've been toggling. So did I just do that, Trustee Thompson?
Yes, you
can't
did.
Believe
yes.
I just did that. I'm losing my mind. Thank mm-hmm. you very much. But that's not on the agenda tonight. So anyway, thank you very much. But I want to say here is that there will be a media release regarding the administrative placements, and they will be distributed tomorrow morning. And thank you very much. That is my report.
Thank you very much. That takes us to our notice of motion section. Are there any notice of motion, any new notice of motion anyone's bringing forward tonight? I see none. So the committees with trustee representation, you've been provided with a copy of the trustee, the committees with trustee representation, and asked to note your areas of interest and return it to Bev Sims. The submissions will be collated and Vice Chair Johnstone and myself and Director Wilder will do our best to fairly distribute that with everyone's requests. And as I mentioned earlier, please remember that our business committee is a committee of the whole board and our policy is a standing committee. And it's not on our list now because it is assumed if you signed up to it before, you're still on it. And if you are unable to fulfill that obligation, please let Bev know.
And point of information here, Trustee Thompson, is that the committee of the whole board, the business committee meeting is actually essentially a compulsory committee of our board. And that's different than the standing committee, so that every trustee should be attending that. And if they're not, they should be definitely giving regrets. So thank you. Sorry about that.
No, that's great. A great clarification. So if you could make sure that you get that back to Bev Sims, that would be terrific. So reports for information. I would like to invite student trustee Trinity Shaw to provide our student senate report for us this evening.
Hello and good evening. I have a short report for you tonight. Our Senate within the last month has had a calm yet productive set of weeks, Bullying Prevention Week being one such topic of ours. We have distributed resources within our schools, sharing links to educational websites, and have made many efforts to reach out to students who may be in need of help. Students throughout our board have expressed their concerns about the sudden shift taking place at the start of the second semester regarding the transition to normal four-period semesters once again. This has many contemplating whether they will be ready for such change, though ultimately most agree that this will be a good thing to return to, especially with so many students being so close to making their transition from high school to post-secondary learning. Our schools have many things planned and up and running for this December as we move so quickly into the holiday season. Cash and food drives have been set into motion with copious amounts of students happy to contribute to their respective causes. Most are positively ecstatic to be able to be part of something bigger and to help out during these trying times. We had another two speakers grace our meetings this month as well. Superintendent of Education Lauren Penner-Lipsett and John Farmer from the Canadian Mental Health Association. We were delighted to host them and learned a lot from their time with us. I would now like to thank you for your time. That is my report.
Thank you very much. Trustees, have any questions or comments? I see none. Thank you very much. So we're to staff reports. I would like to invite Superintendent of Business Services, Cummings, to speak to this report. I'd like a mover and a seconder that the Blue Water District School Board receive the 2020-2021 financial statements report and 2020-2021 consolidated financial statements report for information. I see Trustee Dawson and Trustee Atkinson, and welcome Superintendent Cummings.
Thank you, Chair Thompson, and congratulations on your appointment, as well to Vice Chair Johnstone.
Thank you.
I would like to share my screen with you to help present this report. It seems to make it much easier. Can you let me see if you know if you can see that?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you. So good evening. It is my pleasure again this year to present you the 2020-21 financial statements. Joining me this evening is Andrew Lowe, our Manager of Financial Services, and Linda Bross, partner at BDO Canada. They will be speaking at different points in tonight's presentation. A look at some of the items we'll cover this evening. We'll get right into it here. So if you notice in your board package, you'll have the annual financial information that includes your financial report and the financial statements for 2020-21. I will provide an overview of this information and look at some specific areas of interest from the past year. We know there were a lot. This information was reviewed and approved by the audit committee at their November meeting and included our external auditor's report at that meeting. As usual, the 2021-22 financial statement package was prepared by staff in accordance with Financial Administration Act, supplemented by the Ontario Ministry of Education Memorandum 2004-B2 and Ontario Reg 395/11 of the Financial Administration Act. So, summary of the events. If you recall, last year was quite eventful and unpredictable school year. Fortunately, past decisions that we've made to proactively address our long-term financial sustainability has resulted in the board's ability to successfully navigate through these types of years of uncertainty. Notable financial events from last year included the following: a significant amount of pandemic funding and expenses to support school reopening, remote learning, and enhanced health and safety measures. Continued optimization of air quality and ventilation, and special education and mental health supports. We also see in the financials the effect of collective bargaining that was completed in 2019-20 and the newly agreed upon increases that were implemented in 2021. As well, 2019-20 had a total of 10 strike days among all labor groups, meaning that the year-over-year salary comparisons in the financials do look a little skewed due to the number of days worked. The largest unforeseen impact of the pandemic was the sharp decrease in enrollment, particularly in kindergarten and grades 1 to 3. Budget development was well underway prior to the onset of the pandemic used the enrollment projections from prior years. Unforeseen enrollment decreases were felt across the province, and as such, province introduced one-time GSN stabilization funding. The stabilization funding was implemented to mitigate the financial impact on enrollment decreases due to COVID-19. As such, boards had the ability to preserve budget staffing and programming levels throughout the year. For Blue Water, the funding totaled $3.3 million. Ministerial closure orders were announced for the first part of January 2021 and from April 16th to the end of the school year, which essentially, in the financial world, halted all spending and significantly decreased utilities, contractual services, and our supply costs. As a result of the decreases in expenses and overall spending, the board was able to contribute to contingency reserves, allowing for financial flexibility and the ability to respond to changes while mitigating risks. So our position, you'll see the results present a much stronger financial position that will support the board's long-term financial sustainability. Total assets were up by $6 million to $376 million. This was largely related to increased capital additions, including the recognition of the Georgian Bay Community School. As part of the budget process, the board committed to establishing a capital and technology reserve. These financial results have provided the opportunity to contribute $2 million to capital reserve, $2 million to a technology reserve, and an additional $4.1 million added to the contingency reserve, getting us into the $17 million area, which is really quite a fair target based on the $235 million budget. And if you think that a contingency reserve should be in the 5 to 10%, we are right in the middle of that at $17 million. Blue Water finds itself in a respectable financial position for the fourth straight year and is well positioned to deal with some uncertainty in the future based on a return from the deficit many years ago. I'm going to ask Andrew Lowe, of our Manager of Financial Services, to go through the Consolidated Statement of Financial Position and the following slide. Andrew?
Thank you, Rob. The Consolidated Statement of Financial Position is found on page 6 of the Financial Statement Package. It shows the financial assets, liabilities, and non-financial assets. This slide is an abbreviated version and shows the year-over-year change from comparative purposes. So the board's financial position continues to improve, building on the momentum of prior years and growing the accumulated surplus. Effective management and strong financial responsibility has moved us from a perennial deficit prior to 2016-17 to a surplus position of $36.6 million. The net increase in non-financial assets is mainly related to $23.5 million in capital additions through funding from capital priorities, school condition improvement, community hub sources, and school renewal. This is partially offset by disposals and amortization. The decrease in financial assets is mostly related to a decrease in receivables from municipalities who had delayed installment dates in 2020 as a form of pandemic relief. This is offset by the increase to the delayed grant payment. The decrease in financial liabilities is related to a decrease in payables and accruals, including a payable for the aforementioned tax revenue fronted by the ministry and accruals for collectively bargained retroactive increases that were accrued in 2019-20 and paid out in 2020-21. And of course, a continued reduction of long-term debt. These factors are partially offset by increases to deferred revenue and deferred capital contributions. Next slide here. So the Consolidated Statement of Operations shows the revenues, expenses, and resulting annual surplus deficit compared to the approved budget. It's important to note that for financial statement purposes, results are compared to the original budget, which varies based on changes in enrollment, salaries, and other changes throughout the year that are reported through interim reporting. So revenue increased from budget due to pandemic relief funding that was announced to ensure the health and safety of students and staff, continued air quality and optimization in schools, support for mental health and special education initiatives, and the provision of additional staffing and technology support. Also, COVID-19 resilience infrastructure funding, or infrastructure stream, or CVRIS, which we call it, that funding to improve the health and safety conditions in schools was also introduced after budget. These revenues were partially offset by increased contributions to deferred revenue due to decreased spending from ministerial closures, and a decrease in other revenues due to COVID-19 and as community education and permit programs did not operate in 2020-21. Overall, expenses changed from budget due to a decrease in school-generated fund activities, school budget and operational savings due to the closure periods, and a decrease in professional development due to COVID-19 restrictions.
Thanks, Andy. At this point, is there any comments or questions? There's a couple slides left, but in case you have a question on the top of your mind, and I cannot see the screen right now. Okay, I'll carry on. So one of the charts we like to bring forward, of course, is how our funds are directed primarily to the classroom and the accommodation of our students. And we show that by showing the remainder of the funding, so from the administration costs. Administration costs at 6.3 million remain stable and are down slightly from last year by 2 points to 2.8% of total expenses. This ratio illustrates the level of efficiency in delivering education to our students and ensuring almost all funding is directly related to student well-being and achievement. These are exemplary numbers and generally exceed those of our public sector counterparts. Administration expenses would include areas such as accounting, HR, corporate services, payroll, purchasing, areas like that. So we're holding that line under 3%. It's fairly stable. The other one we like to talk about is our unsupported debt level. We talk about this one because it's an area that we have a little bit of, there is no support from the ministry to pay it off. It is the debt obligations the board has taken on over the years that is specifically not funded by the ministry. Debt gets paid down over time from grants and flexible funding envelopes such as administration. The commitment to this reduction is admirable and contributes to our stronger financial position. So you can see we've been steadily declining in this area. We have not taken on any extra unsupported debt in the last 7 years. And our next level, we're probably going to see about 436,000 drop off in 2023. And then we'll see another small portion drop off in 2028, maybe about 700,000. Then the largest amount from that unsupported debt is will fall off in 2034. So to review, our short-term financial position has improved by successfully navigating through a challenging school year. As we move forward through 21-22, we must consider the ongoing financial pressures associated with the pandemic and the underlying uncertainty. Past decisions to proactively address our long-term financial sustainability have positioned the board to adequately support potential funding gaps resulting from COVID-19 or other events, while focusing on the health, safety, and wellness of the students and staff, and maximizing achievement through promotion of learning recovery and re-engagement. As financial sustainability outlook improves, opportunities for sustainable reinvestment may be evaluated within alignment of board priorities and the stewardship of resources in a long-term, financially sustainable manner. So with us this evening is Linda Bross, partner from BDO Canada, with a review of the external auditor's report on our consolidated financial statements. Linda, feel free to take it away.
Thank you, Rob. I'm going to share my screen here.
Try to stop sharing.
Okay, did that work?
Yes, it did.
Yeah, it's good, Linda.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'm not getting the shared screen for some reason, but don't worry about it.
Okay. It is in your package. It's probably page 4 of the financial statements. So I'm just going to review the independent auditor's report. So we have audited the consolidated financial statements of the Blue Water District School Board as at August 31st, 2021. And the notes and various statements that make up that financial statement package. In our opinion, the financial statements for the year ended August 31st, 2021 are prepared in all material respects in accordance with the basis of accounting described in note 1 to the financial statements. We conducted our audit in accordance with Canadian Generally Accepted Auditing Standards. We are independent of the school board, and we believe that the audit evidence we have obtained is sufficient and appropriate to provide a basis for our opinion. You'll see that there's an emphasis of matter noted in our report That's to note that the financial statements have been prepared in accordance with the ministry guidelines, which are based on Canadian public sector accounting standards, but there's some significant differences in what the ministry wants. So those are all described in note one to the financial statements. Management is responsible for the preparation of the financial statements, and those charged with governance are responsible for overseeing the financial reporting process of the financial statements. The auditor's responsibilities are to obtain reasonable assurance that the financial statements as a whole are free from material misstatement. As part of our audit, in accordance with Canadian generally accepted auditing standards, we assess the risks, we obtain understanding of the internal controls, we evaluate the appropriateness of accounting policies and accounting estimates and the related disclosures that are made by management, and we obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence to be able to express an opinion on the financial statements. Our conclusions are based on audit evidence obtained right up to the date of our auditor's report. So you will note that this report is dated November 8th, which was the date of the audit committee meeting. Are there any questions?
Trustees have any questions or comments? Jim, your hand has been up the whole time, so I'm assuming that's not new, or maybe you do have a comment.
Sorry, I can't get it to go off. I keep clicking and it won't go down.
No worries. Anybody else have any questions or comments? I see none. Thank you, Linda.
Thank you.
Thanks, Linda. Chair Thompson, that concludes our report for this evening.
Excellent. Trustee Johnstone. Yes.
Okay. Thank you. And I'm having trouble like Trustee Dawson too. Anyway, I just wanted to say, when I heard that the debt would be finally paid off by 2034, that I hope not to be a school trustee, but still very much alive.
Superintendent Cummings, one of the questions that I have asked you many times, and I'm asking again, not because I haven't heard your answer, but because other people might appreciate hearing the information. We hear of people, our debt, our interest rates have been quite low of recent, and I wondered why we couldn't renegotiate our loan rates with the lower interest rates. And I wondered if you could just answer that for everyone's behalf.
Yeah, absolutely. Through the chair, in the notes to the financial statements, you'll see a long list of the debt instruments. I believe it's note 8, 9, somewhere in there. It's in the same area pretty much every year. That lists the different interest rates and different loans that are outstanding. Most of those, like 90% of them, are supported by the ministry, and they're in fixed contract loan agreements. So there's no opportunity to renegotiate those loans at this time. And the unsupported ones as well. Those are in place with a fixed rate, fixed agreement term. There's no option for us to renegotiate.
Thank you. I have another question, but I will look if anyone else has one before I ask it. My other question, and perhaps it's a mulling over question for a further answer, but it is great that we are so efficient in our administrative line, but given that we're in a better financial position than we've been in for a long time, and given the challenges that I know our administrative people carry on their shoulders, is there a need to be increasing that line so that we have more people in our administrative for assistance?
Thank you, Chair Thompson. That's a great question. There is always a need to want to do more and to build up the resources to do more at an administrative level. The other side of the coin to saying, hey, we're very efficient, That is also a little bit by design. It's also how we're funded. So when you look at the school board administration grant, the SBAG grant, it's limited to what we receive, and we really don't overspend that allocation. So it's a little bit by design that we're efficient. Certainly, if the opportunity came up that we could actually expand that, we would gladly. We have lots of ways we would like to actually use those funds for administration if we could. But yeah, certainly something we would look at as we go forward. Dropping 2 points to 2.8 is actually a bit of breathing room in terms of when you think about it. We could probably make it up to, I think, 3.2 without actually being up against the envelope wall on the SBAG.
Thank you. I know that our bigger boards have people that carry lots of different portfolio titles, and I guess that's based on the student enrollment in the board, based on what you just answered. But I don't want us to be in a risky position because we're trying to be so lean.
Thank you, Chair Thompson. I would also provide the information that on January 4th at the Business Committee, you will be seeing the interim report number one from this year, and the impact of that increase in enrollment you will see very clearly in the presentation coming to you.
Excellent.
Thank
you.
Raise the question again.
Is there any other questions or comments? I see none. It was moved by Trustee Dawson and seconded by Trustee Atkinson that the Blue Water District School Board received the 2020-2021 financial statements report and the 2020-2021 consolidated financial statements report for information. All in favor? Thank you. That is carried. And we'll continue with Superintendent of Business Services, Cummings. But I'm looking for a mover and a seconder that the Blue Water District School Board approve the following banking resolutions for 2022. General Banking Resolution, Certificate of Officers and Directors, and the General Borrowing Resolution of $50 million. Could I have a mover? I see Trustee McComb and Trustee Johnstone. And go ahead, Superintendent Cummings.
Thank you, Chair Thompson. So annually, with our initial meeting of the board, we update our banking resolution information. So the resolutions in front of you, the general banking resolution appoints CIBC as our banker for another year. The certificate of officers and directors updates the authorized signatures for the banking with our chair and vice chair. And of course, the general borrowing resolution provides an upwards borrowing amount to deal with the cash flows around capital priorities and other things too, but we focus this one on the capital priorities. When you're in the midst of building two to three schools at any given time, managing the cash flow, you need a bit of a safety net. So we have this borrowing resolution of up to $50 million should we need it. We don't usually need it. We manage the cash flow fairly well.
Trustees have questions or comments. Trustee Dawson, I see your hand is up, but just give me a single if you're struggling.
Sorry, put it up before and it won't come down again.
No worries. Anybody else have a question or comment? I see none. So it was moved by Trustee McComb, seconded by Trustee Johnstone. I just read the motion, so I'm not going to read it again. All in favor? Thank you. That is carried. So we're to our school update. I'd like to invite the Superintendent of Education, Elliot, to speak to the report, but I'll be looking for a mover and seconder to put this on the floor, that the Blue Water District School Board received the school update report for information. I see Trustee Dawson and Trustee Johnstone.
Sorry, I just came with my hand
up. Well, you just were able to move.
I'll go ahead.
Yes, so go
good
ahead.
Good evening. I am pleased to begin the school update this evening. With the December break approaching, the Ministry of Education has provided new operational guidance to mitigate risk to the health and well-being of staff and students, as well as to support a return to pre-pandemic learning environments. Some of the key changes that are occurring are, first, only virtual parent-teacher conferences and interviews are permitted at this time. Elementary and secondary schools are required to implement the daily on-site confirmation of self-screening prior to or upon arrival at school for the first 2 weeks following the winter break. Every student will be able to take home a rapid antigen screening kit that contains 5 tests during the winter break. These test kits are voluntary and are to be completed at home prior to the return to the classroom in January. Schools are reminded to ensure that families are aware that unvaccinated children under the age of 12 who travel internationally with a fully vaccinated companion aren't permitted to attend school for 14 days following their return. Effective on January 2022, elementary in-person school assemblies or other school and student gatherings will not be permitted. So we'll be having virtual assemblies only. And then as you saw tonight, well, tonight's music was in a class, but the use of wind instruments is permitted indoors within a cohort in elementary and in a mixed cohort in secondary. This is great news for our schools who can now move forward with school bands with appropriate distancing and safety measures. Each school has received enough PCR tests to cover 10% of their population. And we use these tests with the guidance of public health and did so, for example, with the recent cases at Hall and Chatsworth. This is my portion of the school update report. I'm happy to answer any questions and then I'll pass the mic over to Superintendent Penner-Lipset.
Thank you. Any questions for Superintendent Elliott? I see none. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I have the next portion of the school update report for you this evening, and I'm here to give you an update around inclement weather and instruction. So as you're aware, we experience some really wonderful winter weather here in Grey and Bruce counties. The winter weather at times can lead to bus cancellations or inclement weather days in our schools, which you will notice we've had a couple already this week in certain areas of the board. It's not unusual for schools in our district to experience upwards of 15 to 18 inclement weather days per school year. And as you know, this can represent a sizable portion of academic year for our students. So to help mitigate days without in-person learning for many of our students, we've asked our teaching staff to move to online learning where possible on inclement weather days for this school year. Teachers have been asked to create an online classroom for their students in preparation for a move to online learning at any point this year as needed. And teachers may post work for students to complete synchronously or asynchronously, and teachers will make themselves available online where possible on inclement weather days to support students. Although there'll be no new brand new learning or new concepts introduced or taught on these inclement weather days, the learning opportunities for students could include things like teacher conferencing and reinforcement or practice of a concept already learned in the class. It's also a great opportunity for students to work on a project or other work that allows them to practice or reinforce skills and concepts that they're already learning about at school. It will not be a requirement for students to attend online learning on these days. As we understand, not every student may be able or to participate, but we feel it's really important to make this opportunity available to them if they choose to participate or connect with their teacher on this day. So we feel that this plan maximizes opportunities for our students and our teachers to work together to provide valuable learning experiences when in-person learning is not possible. So I'm happy to take any questions or comments about learning on inclement weather days.
Thank you. I see Trustee Lutz has a comment or question.
Yes, thank you very much. I just have a question about the equity of this plan, given that we know many students needed devices from the school board in order to participate in online learning at times when the schools have been closed. So my question is, I realize attendance isn't taken and it's not mandatory, but if a student wants to participate, should not all students who want have the tools to be able to do that? And if so, how are we providing them? Thank you.
Thanks for the question. And we do understand and hear what you're saying around equity. And we've discussed this at great length. Right now on the board, as you know, we don't, students don't have a one-to-one ratio for devices, for example. We were able to support families during school closure times. That might, you know, that's not always the case on inclement weather day, if it's a one day here or one day there. So we know that some students may not be able to access the online class environment from home, but we do want to make it available for those that can access the online environment. And if there's students that cannot for reasons around maybe they don't have sufficient internet or they don't have sufficient technology at home, teachers should be aware of this. They have been working with their classes already on remote readiness plans. They've introduced the online platform. So they're having discussions with students around this. And if students aren't able to access, teachers will have a sense of this and they can work together to see if there's a way to continue, you know, some reading concepts at home on an inclement weather day if a family chooses, or to practice some mathematics concepts, for example, mathematics skills at home during inclement weather days, if possible. Many of our, especially in primary elementary, for example, they have some take-home programs or reading programs at homes and things like that. So we just want to give the opportunity to continue with that on an inclement weather day. Parents can also speak with teachers about, you know, what opportunities there might be in this regard, but you know, at this point, we definitely don't have a one-to-one ratio around, you know, devices at home for every student. And I see Superintendent LeFave, you also popped on for this part because you support instruction as well. So I don't know if you have further comments.
No, I would echo some of the same things that you were saying, Superintendent Penner-Lipset. Again, we don't have a one-to-one ratio for our devices at home, but certainly students who would not have a device at home, it is important for them to obviously, you know, connect with the teachers and make sure that they know what is expected of them so that they can still work at home on an inclement weather day. As we have in the past, students have been able to do that as well prior to the time that we've entered COVID and we've been using Teams and been online or transitioned to online learning. I would also, I would echo those same sentiments that you had stated.
Trustee Lutz, did you have a follow-up?
Yes, I do, and partially a clarification, because if we are suggesting, so first of all, I believe we have a requirement to provide educational opportunities that are accessible to all of our students. So that's just point one. But to go beyond that, if we are suggesting that there be offline options, why is that not simply the requirement instead of requiring teachers to do two sets of instructional opportunities for snow days, which in my opinion are supposed to be, you know, a bonus day gift from, you know, the weather forecasters. Oh, I've had talks with Jamie. Brightspace doesn't work in our house during snow days. So, but my question remains that, especially considering so much about our students and what we want to provide for them that if we are suggesting there be offline alternatives, why is that not simply just the standard? And I do know that another school board, it was Halton actually, put out a wonderful press release before saying that if we do not have devices to send home, then we can't expect to do online learning, as that is disequitable to our students. So again, I'd like you to clarify why we're presenting something that we know is disequitable from the get-go. Thank you.
Certainly in the situation of other boards, I know other boards in the southern part of the province have very few snow days. As I think Superintendent Penner-Lipset had stated, we're quite aware that a number of our schools have anywhere up to 18 snow days in the school year, which represents about 10% of a school year, which is a sizable portion. And if we can provide even a small opportunity for students to be able to consolidate concepts or look at or obtain, you know, an opportunity to be able to, you know, work on a project or something like that, then we felt that that was a valuable consideration for us to make.
Trustee Johnstone.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much. I do know when I was reading, just for some clarification for everyone, the information that came out of Halton is they were talking about when schools were closed. And as we know, especially in urban boards, they rarely, like it's totally rare that they would have actually closed a building, where in boards where you have more wild weather like we do in Grey Bruce or, you know, Northern, it's much more likely that schools are actually going to be closed. Having said that, I think that just talking about equity inclusion, this would be a great topic to bring forward to the Equity Inclusion Committee for some brainstorming and you know, looking at that equity piece. So that is my suggestion here.
Thank you. I just had a question too, and then we'll go back to you, Trustee Lutz. I'm just wondering if you can clarify for me. We're talking about the students here, but often when we have snow days in Grey Bruce, the announcement will be the buses aren't running, but the schools are open for those who can get there safely. What is the expectation for staff?
I can, through the chair, sure. I can answer that one, and Superintendent Tang can also jump in if needed on the staff piece. But staff try to get to their work location if they can do so safely. So, you know, they check the weather, they set out, they try the drive, and they try to get to their work location safely. There is a procedure around if staff feel it's depending on the collective bargaining unit, they may have an alternate work location, so that might be closer to home for them, for example. So if they feel if they're not able to make it to their assigned work location, then there's an alternate that might be closer that they may go to, or they may check in to see if they're needed at that alternate work location. And otherwise, then they may be home if they feel that it's really unsafe. Superintendent Tang, I don't know if I captured that.
No, I think that's fine. Thank you.
Supplementary on it. I mean, we've learned a lot of things over COVID. And part of it is that we're much better at managing, as we are an example of, online. And I'm wondering, what happens with our board staff, our board of, like our central staff? How does that get handled for them on an inclement day?
So we have a similar circumstance for people who work at the education center. The primary expectation is if they feel it is safe to do so, they are to come to work. If it isn't safe to do so, or if they don't feel it's safe to do so, they could go to their nearest Blue Water location if they're able to work from there. or they could, if they have their computer available, they might be able to work from home.
Excellent. It's great that we're taking everyone's safety into consideration when we're doing this. Trustee Dawson, I thought I saw your hand up, and if not, did I see your hand?
Yes, you did. I just
wanted okay, I'm going to go to you, and then I'll go back to Trustee Lutz.
I just wanted to make a comment on what Superintendent Lauren Penner-Lips had said. When I was in the game and we had days like this, I had prearranged with a similar teacher who lived in a different location that we would swap schools that day. And this arrangement was made to the principal. So, for instance, if I couldn't get to Meaford, I would go to Beaver Crest. She couldn't get to Beaver Crest, she would go to Meaford. So the spot would be covered. And since we did this on every day, we sort of knew what that person was doing. We're able to pick up the pieces from them and carry on. So just an observation.
Thank you. Trustee Lutz.
Thank you. It was just a comment because I understand the concern about learning loss due to snow days, but I don't know, maybe I'm assuming the rest of you experienced snow days in your days as a student. And I remember years with 10, 15 more, and our incredible teachers in the school board found great ways to make sure we still covered the curriculum. We figured things out. You know, there was a lot of adaptability, and I really struggle with this idea that we're going to offer something that is knowingly not accessible to all of our students when there have been snow days long before there was online learning, and there were ways to figure it out and mitigate learning loss. So I think that's just something very important that needs to be considered, that this has always been there and that there are solutions other than online learning. Thank you.
And I may just make one comment. I remember our girls having a lot of snow days when they were young, and they had a mom that would say, oh, come on, this is an opportunity for you to do whatever. And my daughter would say to me, I'm going to get that done in the summer so I can have an official snow day when it comes. I suspect it's always been thus. There are kids that have had opportunity on those days and kids that have not. And we have somehow managed to, the teachers have figured out how we support those other students. But that's my observation as a non-teacher. But I think that's just the reality of our circumstances. Some kids have more opportunity and privilege than some others. Trustee Morgan.
I agree very much with what you've just said, Chair. And I also want to take it one step farther, having had kids who experienced snow days 12 in a row one year. I think that if you look at kids back in the day, and I will say your kids are probably of that age, they were a little more self-disciplined, and maybe we should be looking at that rather than beating up the teachers trying to get them doing all things for all people. Thank you.
I don't see any other questions or comments. It was moved by Trustee Dawson, seconded by I'm going ahead without letting I'm sorry,
it's okay.
Lauren.
Oh, it's no, not at all. I was just going to turn it over to Superintendent Lefebvre when we were finished with the inclement weather discussion.
And so I actually knew that, so I apologize.
Thank you. And I will be the last speaker for the school report, just so you're aware. And I wanted to provide an update to you regarding semester two. So based on the advice from the Ontario Ministry of Education and with approval from the Grey Bruce Public Health, Blue Water District School Board secondary schools will return to the regular semester system effective February 4th, 2022. The regular system has 4 75-minute classes scheduled each day of the week. This schedule will repeat every week of the semester with no rotation of classes. Currently, the modified semester consists of 2 half-day classes, so our A and B periods, and the following week with the C and D classes. Starting in February, every week will return to 4 75-minute classes. These will actually be numbered 1, 2, 3, 4 versus A, B, C, D, simply because of the move within our internal student information system from one system to the next. We are actually going to number the classes 1, 2, 3, 4 every day in that order. We require the remaining time in this semester, semester one, to communicate with students and families and honor the existing schedules of students, including co-op placements that are already arranged with current employers. Our co-op teachers will also need time to arrange new schedules for semester two, now that we're returning to a regular semester schedule. The benefits of returning to a regular semester include the ability of students to focus on classes without interruption, providing continuity of instruction. A one-week break from class can be difficult for some students to manage. Our staff will also return to a daily preparation period versus teaching all day for 1 week with no preparation period. Our Information and Communication Technology ICT department has been busy working with our student information system vendor to manage the transition between the modified and regular semester systems. I'd be happy to take any questions regarding the move to a regular semester system in semester two.
Trustee Lutz, go ahead.
Thank you. It was brought up to me by one of the students in our system about use of lockers if they are returning to a normal semester system, and I believe that is the plan. And so I just wanted to ask, going back to this system and going back to using lockers, what will contact tracing look like and how will that work for if there is a case of COVID in the school? Thank you.
I did pop on, if that's okay through the chair, I can answer this question. So absolutely, having 4 periods a day will make contact tracing a little bit more complex, just as this year's system was more complex over last year's. So the benefit of having 1 class per week as last year would be if there was a COVID case in the school, only the students in that 1 class would be dismissed. What we have found this year is in many circumstances, not all, it does depend on the variant of COVID that public health believes that we're dealing with, but depending on the situation, in most circumstances and secondary vaccinated students are able to continue attending school. And with the vaccination rate increasing, we're hoping that that will support us to get through with the semestered system. There is an opportunity if public health feels it's necessary, and hopefully we don't go there, that we could do a switch to remote learning, or they do have the ability to close a school if necessary. That's not something that we want to need to do, but that the public health does have that ability.
Any other questions or comments? I just wanted to make a comment. There were some boards that were really pushing to go back to this system as soon as possible. And I think it's a good move that we're waiting until the beginning of second semester for the reasons that you've pointed out. There are transitions that need to be done and people that were in co-op. And I think providing people with the certainty of what's happening is as important. It was the uncertainty that was causing some grief, but I think most are looking forward to the return to that, but I'm glad we're waiting until the natural transition time. So I'm going to do this again, and I think I'm okay this time. It was moved by Trustee Dawson and seconded by Trustee Johnstone that the Blue Water District School Board receive the school update report for information. All in favor, please. Thank you. That is carried. So This takes us down to our annual report from the Director of Education. So I'll invite Director of Education Wilder to speak to this report, but first I'll be looking for a mover and a seconder that the Blue Water District School Board receive the Director's Annual Report 2021 for information. Could I have a mover? I see Trustee McComb and Trustee Morgan. Thank you, and welcome, Director Wilder.
Thank you very much, Chair Thompson, and congratulations to you and Vice Chair Johnstone. It's an absolute pleasure to bring forward the Director's Annual Report. This report is an ability for us to highlight our progress and our successes and our celebrations throughout the year. And just to clarify, this is a calendar year. The Director's Annual Report, the presentation of the report is actually a yearly requirement under the Education Act. And so it is the year of 2021. So it goes really from the initial meeting of the board all the way to this meeting. So I welcome Jamie Pettit. Jamie is with us this evening and he has just posted the Director's Annual Report, which you had in your packages ahead of time. So I do hope you've had a chance to review. I would like to acknowledge and thank Jamie for all of the work he did supporting the Director's Annual Report, as well as the design of it. Credit goes to Brenna Lawrence, who is in corporate services. She's an executive assistant in our office. She did some great work, and you'll see this front page as well. I would like to acknowledge the work of a Grey Highland Secondary School student, Paige Moulton. She's part of a specialist high skills major course, so she did the design of this front page. We always do appreciate the support of students in this regard. So thank you to Jamie, Brenna, and Paige. Really, the reflection of a Director's Annual Report is a collective effort. Thanks to you, the trustees. We couldn't do it without you, all of their staff, the senior team, and of course, our students and families. And you'll see reflected throughout the report that, as I mentioned, completely a collective effort of everybody's support to get this completed. And it's the nice thing, we frame this around our multi-year strategic plan, so it's completely framed around our four priority areas. So I'd like to Jamie, if you don't mind flipping to the next page, please. So thanks again to Chair Thompson from last year. She has her remarks, and Gabe and Trinity, it's nice to see you there with nice smiling faces. And as well, Gabe and Trinity have outlined there for all of you the student trustee messages and some of the focuses that they had for this, well, the time that they've been with us. When we move to the quick fact page, I always like this page, the quick facts, because it just gives a quick snapshot of our board, including our number of schools, number of students, staff, how geographically large we actually are. I understand we're close to the size of Prince Edward Island, so geography plays a huge part in our board, and just some of the other little statistics that are there. If we go over to priority one, I think it's important for all of us I'm going to read the priorities itself. So priority one for us is a safe, supportive learning community, with the goals being working together to support wellness and foster the strengths, contributions, and overall health of students and staff. So you will recall when we put together this strategic plan, all of you had an opportunity to consult on this. So these are your words and the direction that you've given us, the staff, to work towards. So this first priority, I will not go through it. You've had an opportunity to look, but the first section is around the student well-being, particularly when we're dealing and have been dealing with a lot of COVID management. This was key for us, just ensuring student well-being. And you can see there are three tiers that have been outlined there. The reports have come to you, so you should be familiar with this. So tier one, promotion and prevention, which is for all of our students. And then for some of our students, we get into targeted prevention. And then tier three is intensive intervention and assessment, which is just for a smaller portion of our student population. You will just still on that page, sorry, Jamie, if you just go back and throughout the report, you will see that there are links within the report. So this report is much larger than you see on the paper because there are links that take you to all of the different reports that have been completed in this regard. So you can see here, they're highlighted in a different color. So they pop out a bit from the page in the blue. So they would be reports or information that is really relevant to the priority area that's being discussed. So feel free when you have an opportunity to go through and go on the link so you can gather more information. Continuing on priority one, we have the staff well-being section, the mental health campaigns. There are a lot of different reports in there in terms of mental health, because that certainly has been a huge area of focus for us. And we've been able to hire some a good number of mental health workers. They have a really solid team that's been developed, led by Superintendent Elliott. So it's a great mental health team supporting our students. And thanks very much to the trustees, our accessible personal hygiene products, and our Student Senate. We are able to get that off the ground even before the ministry came forward and funded that. So that was lovely advocacy on the behalf of you, the trustees, and student senators. Priority two is our quality instruction. And our goals under that are providing relevant learning experiences that foster critical and forward thinking, innovation, creativity, and problem solving, as well as using evidence-informed instructional methods to support competency and literacy and numeracy. We're doing our best in that regard. We've talked to you a bit about our difficulties around finding occasional teachers. So our professional development has looked a little bit different this past year because we've had to be really reflective on how we deliver it. Some sessions have been voluntary sessions that staff could attend, but it's just something we still need to continue to focus on because it is a priority for us. The reports there that have been listed, we have our some that you've recently had, actually just recently we had the summer school summer learning, and of course there's a whole section there on the equity inclusion, which is big, and we've just had one meeting of, I know Chair, our Vice Chair Johnstone had referenced the Equity and Diversity and Inclusion Committee recently. So that's something that's just up and running. And if we go to the next page, Jamie, please. So continuing on with the quality instruction, we have some other ones there that were focused on all of that. Just our OEAP presentations. We had Dave Barrett with us, our OEAP coordinator, for quite a few presentations, but it's lovely to know that in the province we have such huge numbers of OEAP students. He does an amazing job of supporting them. And the same can be said for the work that's done in Indigenous education. That picture there is actually a picture of the table, the top of the table from SDSS Reconciliation Hall. And we have that lovely presentation with the staff and elders that support SDSS. So that's what that picture is. Just a priority three is our community engagement, and I won't read the strategic goals there, but it's just about communicating effectively with our parents and our community. And we've had to look at that quite a bit differently during COVID. And I would say that our communication has increased greatly. We've used thought exchange very widely. There's been more communications that have gone out from myself as a director and from principals. We've supported principals in the messaging around COVID protocols. Just recently, trustees will know, the one evening I sent you quite a few emails in a row just about some of the testing that was the ministry's providing for families. And so you can see the increase. I want to share with you what families will be getting. So you can see the increase in communication that's going out to families. So we've just had to engage differently with them too. And I would say with virtual learning, our parents became much more engaged during the time that all students were at home learning. It was just a different reality for them, and they could actually observe and sit in classes and hear what their children were learning. So it was communication, I think, is something that we've done a really good job on, just and very, very differently than we've ever had to do before. And as well, I just wanted to highlight the parent portal. That is something you remember, again, as trustees, we sat around the table. I think it was for most of you sitting around the table, and that was a suggestion made probably 3-4 years ago that that would be a good idea. So we are in very, very initial stages of investigating that. So there's a lot more information to come on that. but I think that that'd be a really nice opportunity for our parents to have a one-stop shop, so to speak, to get information on their children's achievement in schools. And continuing on, please, Jamie. Oh yes, Instagram. Instagram, I know Jamie had done some research and found that that seems to be where a lot of people are going for their communications. So it's up and running, and I hope that all of you have joined. There are lots of great little snippets that get posted there. It's a great way for us to communicate. And continuing, priority four. I mean, a lot of our meeting, business committee tonight and our board meeting, was spent on our stewardship of resources. So I just want to again congratulate the finance department and all of the trustees for decisions you've made over the years, and our staff for the work they've done in that regard, because it's nice to be in a different position than I've spent most of my career as a senior team member. We've been in a deficit for so long, so it's lovely to be there. And just wrapping that up, Jamie, if you want to flip over. On just the last page, it's just nice that we can profile both on the last page our senior team, our senior team, our board of trustees, and our student senators and trustees there at the bottom. So it's nice to see all of our smiling faces all together in one spot. So as I said, it's my pleasure to present to you all the director's annual report for this year.
Thank you very much. Do trustees have any questions or comments? Not to put you on the spot, Director Wilder, but as both myself and Vice Chair Johnstone referenced, we're moving into our last year of this term of the Board of Trustees, and I wondered if, and perhaps it doesn't have to be right now, but if you could give some consideration, or if you have thoughts of areas that you would like us as a Board of Trustees to look specifically at as we move forward in our work in this coming year.
Okay, I will take that away, and certainly we can have further discussions.
Thank you. I see no other hands. So it was moved by Trustee McComb and seconded by Trustee Morgan that the Blue Water District School Board received the director's annual report 2021 for information. All in favor? Thank you, that's carried. That takes us to communications. We have no correspondence for our meeting tonight. No correspondence been received. Are there any announcements? Student trustees, staff, Ministry of Education, OPSPA? Trustee Johnstone?
Yes, thank you very much. So you would have received from BEV a notice about whether you're interested in attending PES this year. It will be virtual. And the reason you're receiving that from Bev is that it's kind of like she will submit to OPSPA everybody, so that's why she was asking. And I don't know this, Bev, but is there any kind of cutoff, or you know, how's that working in terms of that? She might be able to actually speak to that, because I know that when we met in person, there was a whole thing about and all had to do with hotel rooms. We don't have that now, so I don't know exactly if you can wait until the last minute or how that's actually going to work. And there's that, and there's also, and I'm just going to go look. I haven't looked recently, and because I'd participated through the regional meeting and, of course, at the Board of OPSPA, but there has been what you would have received from OPSPA. They were asking you to basically join in. It was like focus group things. So please, when you receive those emails, if you have a bit of time, it would be great to, spend a little time, you know, even if it's not as long as they can be there, because they really want a viewpoint of all trustees across the province. You know, although I go to the board table and I do try to represent the point of view of the board, obviously within the board itself, there's different trustees with different ideas, or, you see things differently than, because I'm in the municipality of Kincardine. You could be a different part of the board, and it's so important. So if you would, I would really appreciate it. And I think it brings a richer context to the things that matter around public education in the province. So thank you.
Any other announcements, or I see none. Are there any out of district meetings, conference and conventions? And I know Trustee Johnstone was just referencing one of those, so we'll go ahead.
Yeah, I'm going to do it backwards. So I talked about, PES, but I'm going to go back to, what is great is that OPSCLA will send to me, and I don't know if you get it, but they'll do, these are the kind of the brief notes, not the minutes, but brief notes of the board of directors meeting. And I asked Bev to send those on to you. So if you have any questions, I'm gladly will answer them to the best of my ability. And if you have any questions afterwards you'd like to ask, then for sure contact me. I'm of course available by email or by telephone.
Thank you. And just for everybody, as Trustee Johnstone was saying, I think if COVID's done anything, in some ways it's a great equalizer, because when people were always together face to face, it built a lot of relationships. But I think Trustee Johnstone is feeling that that's not really happening now, and she's at a bit of a loss to know who everybody is. So this really is an opportunity, if you're interested, to everybody's kind of in the same boat. So put your foot in and learn what's going on, because there's lots of interesting information that OPSPA is working on our behalf. So our trustee calendar of events is, as usual, presented in the file for your reference. And I would just like to take the opportunity to wish everybody a really lovely break. I hope you have time to spend with family and to recharge your battery, and I look forward to seeing everybody again in the new year, safe and healthy and happy. So I'll be looking for a mover and a seconder that we adjourn at 8:52 p.m. I see Trustee Johnstone and Trustee McComb, all in favor. And that is carried. Thank you, everybody, and thank you again for your confidence. Enjoy your break.
Happy night, holidays.
Everyone. Happy holidays. Happy holidays.
Bye. Happy holidays.
Keep safe.
Miss Jim's fruitcake.
Yeah, I didn't make any this year, so.
Ah.